44, another area of fellowship. I may need you, brother musician, so if you would stay real close. I may need you as part of my presentation on tonight. We see in verses 44 and 45, fellowship in sharing. When you look at this early church, they engaged in fellowship in sharing. You will notice that those who gathered were believers. People are drawn together by the things they believe in common. It is tragic to say that many of the modern day Christians do not know what they believe, and what little they do believe is not much more than popular motion sprinkled with Christian emotion. We need to know that one of the best ways to achieve, for an achievement to die, is for beliefs to die. If you don't believe anything will happen in your church, nothing will happen. You ought to believe that your church has not yet become the best she can be. You ought to be seeing in your mind a better church in the future than what you see in the present and what you saw in the past. More things would happen if we believe that we and God together can make them happen. By the help of God, the church needs to make something happen and not just wait on something to happen. As you look at the believers sharing, we need to know that the sharing of these believers was due to their love for the Lord and their love for one another. When the Holy Spirit descended upon the believers in Jerusalem, they began to lose sight on self and became Christ-centered and other-centered. They practiced oneness. They had all things in common. They practiced community. For this reason, their lives moved in the direction of J-O-Y. Jesus, others, and yourself. These believers had an intense feeling of responsibility for each other. Christians who are filled with the Holy Spirit cannot bear having too much while others have too little. When you are really filled with the Holy Spirit will not only lift you up so that you can shout, it'll also let you down that you can walk alongside the common people in our community. When the Holy Spirit really takes control of your life, there is nothing you have that is too good to share with someone else. When the Holy Spirit takes control of your life, you cannot have an overflowing checking account and not share some of what's in your account with the lost, the least, and the last. Verse 44 and also verse 45 suggests that none of the members of the church had anything that was too good to share with others. Their only concern was that there was enough for all. They had all things common. That means they shared equally. When you look at it, giving that springs out of love has no limits on its liberality. It is willing to give all. We need to understand that God judges what we give by what we keep. I'm often reminded of a story I read one time where a pastor was asking for gifts to be given at a church. And one of the ladies wrote a check and gave it to the pastor and said, "Pastor, is this enough?" And the pastor said, "Yes, it is enough if it represents you." The woman took the check back because she started thinking about who she was and how good God had been to her. So she wrote another check, gave it to the pastor and said, "Pastor, is this enough?" And the pastor's question was, "Does it represent you?" The lady thought another moment about how good God had been to her, how far God had brought her and blessed her in her life. She took that check back and wrote another check and said, "This check represents me." And I'm wondering, when you give Sunday after Sunday in the church where you hold membership, does your giving represent you? Is your giving a clear indication of how good God has blessed you? I firmly believe that many of the people who sit in our pews Sunday after Sunday are far more selfish and tight in their giving than they are liberal. And you have to remember, God judges the gift by the balance of your checkbook and not the amount of your check. The sharing of these believers was prompted by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit moved them into a feeling of brotherhood. We should not miss the fact that the witness of unselfish living was added to the witness of the spoken word. When they heard the word, God's word so penetrated their hearts that they developed liberal spirits in their giving. There were those among the believers who sold property and they gave the proceeds to anyone who might have a need. This was an indication of their generosity. They gave of their resources without hesitation. These believers were not dispossessing their wealth. They were demonstrating a willingness to place their possessions at the disposal of all who were needed. And in our churches, it does not make sense sometimes for some of our members to get put out. When all of the members of our church have extra resources we could spare, it does not make sense for our next door neighbor to get put out. It doesn't make sense to have hungry families in our churches when members of our churches are cooking more and eating stuff one day and then throwing it out. That's not making sense. But the reason it happens like that, there is no sense of community. And these are people who are wasting, who claim to be guided by the Holy Spirit. But this church in Jerusalem was in fellowship in sharing. But another thing, they were in fellowship in worship. Here's where I'm going to need you, brother musician. You notice verse 46, that it is important to notice that the believers in Jerusalem gathered day by day in the temple with one mind. It's hard to get our members to come every Sunday. But they came every day. What's your excuse that all you can give God is an hour and a half at the most, once a week on Sunday morning? But the early church was in fellowship day by day. And you have to know, when you are missing church on a consistent basis, you are out of fellowship with the rest of the church. Because we saw earlier that they were in fellowship in people. And when you notice, when the Holy Spirit descended, all of the members of the church were in the same place at the same time with the same mind, and all of them received the Holy Spirit at the same time. If the Holy Spirit decided to descend on our church on any given Sunday morning, he couldn't find all of us. But day by day, they were in the temple and they were there for the purpose of worship. The idea of the word one mind is that of one passion, one temperament, or by unanimous consent. All of them decided together. On Monday, we coming back Tuesday. And they decided on Tuesday, we are coming back on Wednesday. And they decided on Wednesday, we are coming back on Thursday. They decided on Thursday, we are coming back on Friday. If that was our church, I got a babysit. Saturday is cooking day. Saturday is shopping day. All of us have certain days that we decide we are going to be out of fellowship with the rest of our church. But they were there every day. They were not content with meeting just once a week. Their relationship with God drew them to the temple each day. They went beyond a once a week routine of gathering for worship. The temple was the house of God and the place of prayer. It was the place where God dwelt. The believers met God each day for worship. They came to God's house daily because they loved God. And since it was the house of God, they said, I've got hell at my house. I'm going to the house of prayer because I can meet God there. And they worship when they got there. Now let me do this just in case I don't get down to my last point. There is a difference between praise and worship. What we have to understand is when we worship God, we focus on the activity of God. When we praise God, we focus on his attributes. Now, if I were minister of music, I want to go back to Monday, Wednesday night. The first song that you did, the song said, we worship for who you are. We worship for who you are. Would you play just a little bit of that? I'm going to sing the way they wrote it. And then I'm going to sing the way it ought to be. All right. We worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. How it's written. Do it again. Let's show you how it ought to be. We praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you for who you are. Who you are is who God is. And whenever we are praising God, we always focus on who God is, not what he's done. So whenever we are singing, we want to be sure of the accuracy of what the song should say and not just what the writers of it said. So the next time, I hope that at your church you sing that song, you will sing it by using the word praise rather than the word worship. Because again, the worship of God focuses on the activity of God and the praise of God focuses on his attributes. And you cannot have praise and worship if there is not truth. And whenever music departments are singing music, they are to sing the truth of God. Because if the truth of God is not being sung, the congregation cannot worship based on a lie, because you are not getting an accurate representation of who God is and what God has done. Let me give you another example of that. I'm still talking about worship. Somebody recorded a song I heard just recently, "Let's Go Back to Eden." My thing is, what for? Because when Jesus comes back, he's not coming back to Eden. He's coming back to the new Jerusalem that's coming down from God. So if you want to go to Eden, I'm saying go ahead. I'm waiting on the new Jerusalem, because that's where the place, that's going to be the place where Jesus is going to set up his kingdom and reign forever and ever. Let me give you one more, and I'm going back to the rest of my little presentation. Another one is that the choirs have sung in recent years, "Wash me over in the blood of the Lamb." My thing is, again, what for? Because the Hebrew writer says that Jesus saves to the uttermost. And the word "uttermost" is a Greek word that means he saves completely. And if Jesus saves completely, why do I need another washing in his blood? Because the songwriter said it like this: what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, how precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I don't need another washing. So all I'm saying is that the church is in fellowship in worship. But when she is in fellowship in worship, she must have the truth of God. Like Luke said concerning the believers in Jerusalem, and day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple. It was not a problem for these believers to meet together daily because they were of one mind. At a certain time of the day, the mind was turned toward the temple and the worship of God. But there's another thing, that was fellowship in joy. Fellowship in joy. The believers in Jerusalem did not come together like a criminal going to a whipping post. The attitude and actions of the believers in Jerusalem was marked by joy. The joy of these believers did not subside after the worship was over. Some of us only are happy at worship time. But the same Holy Spirit that can lift us off our pew and shout inside of the worship is also the same Holy Spirit that can lift the burden off of our hearts so that we can walk through life with a smile on our face. They were gripped by joy. They were so gripped by joy that they broke bread and ate their meals from house to house. So many of us in our churches don't even want to see our church members after the benediction. But in this early church, when the benediction was over, they went home with one another and broke bread together. The only meal most church members have with another church member is if there is a dinner at church. And you know, some of our members even bring their own dinner when the church has dinner. They don't do it in Clarksville. But I got some folk, if it's a church meal, they'll bring their own food. And they'll get over in the corner and take their stuff out of boxes. And they'll eat their own meal with their own family, rather than engaging in a meal and fellowship with the rest of the church. They don't do it up here, but that's how they do it in Nashville. So these believers were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart. The word gladness speaks of extreme or exuberant joy. It has reference to extravagant or unrestrained joy. The joy of the believers overflowed and spilled out on one another. The word gladness speaks of more than a feeling in the heart. It is an expression of the feeling in the heart. The word sincerity speaks of purity of intentions and without guile. When they came together in fellowship with one another, they weren't faking it. You know, some folk in our churches, you speak to them, you ask, how you doing? I'm doing fine. And then as they walk off, we see them out of breath, heifer. Some of the best ventriloquists I've ever seen in my life, I've seen them at church. Church folk can talk about other church folk, and they'll never move. They're just talking. You think they're smiling, and they just talk about everything that's going on in church. But there was no falsehood among these believers. They enjoyed the company of one another away from the place of worship. They did not live in isolation from one another. I guarantee you there's somebody here tonight. By the time we give the benediction, you're going to have your car keys already in your hands. You don't want to see anybody. You don't want to talk to anybody who was here. All you want to do is just get out of here quick, fast, and in a hurry, because you don't want anybody to ask you to do anything by straightening up after the gathering is over. The Holy Spirit exercised such a great influence upon the lives of the believers in Jerusalem that there was no jealousy among them. That's why they all had joy together. They didn't care that one family rode to church in a Mercedes Benz. They didn't care that another family came to church in a Lincoln Town Car. They didn't care that another family came to church and the wife was wearing a St. John and another one was wearing a Hot Chef Lamar suit. They didn't care that the wife walked in with a Louis Vuitton or a Dooney Burke. That didn't matter to them. That was because they had joy together and they were not jealous of one another. We don't have much fellowship because we can't stand to see people rise a step above us. There was no criticism dominating anyone. There was no quarreling among them. The believers who gathered in Jerusalem did not attempt to outdo one another. Therefore, they could not only gather for worship in the same place, they could gather from house to house and eat with one another. They loved one another and they were loving toward one another. We say we love each other, but we're not very loving. The way some folk treat other folk, I just wonder if they love them. I wonder how they treat their enemies. If you treat the folk you love like that, I'd hate to be your enemy. Well, last thing, there's fellowship in praising God. When you look at verse 47, here in this verse, we see the believers magnifying God and multiplying in number. The word praising here in verse 47 is only used of the praise of God. It has reference to lifting up the greatness of God or bragging on God. The believers who gathered in Jerusalem were bragging on God daily. This was the natural expression that resulted from what God had done for them in Jesus Christ. The bragging on God that was done by the believers caused the hearers of the bragging to be drawn to God. The credit for salvation of the saved was due to God and not the preaching of Peter. Those who were saved and baptized among the believers in Jerusalem gave God the praise for their salvation. This kind of praise brought the members of the church in favor with one another and those who were watching. Through the praise of God, the believers were expressing their love for God and one another. This was an important part of their witness because Jesus said the world would be able to recognize their discipleship because of their love. Because of the believers praising God daily, the Lord added to their number day by day. Those who were being saved, the living Christ was active in increasing the number of the fellowship while the fellowship was active loving God and loving one another. The idea of the word saved is that of making safe
from the consequences of sin. Those who were added to the number of the believers were made safe from the consequences of their sin. This was done when their sins were forgiven because of the praise of God and the witness of the believers. Some who were being saved every day, and saved ones were added to the number of the believers. The believers in Jerusalem witnessed by living a life of praise to God. As a result, they found favor with the people. The believers demonstrated the power of the gospel. And they also demonstrated the presence of the Spirit. They were living witnesses for Jesus Christ. Many who were present in Jerusalem noticed the conduct of the believers, and they spoke favor and were drawn under God. I want you to know tonight, if you were really gathered in worship, somebody is going to see the worship of your church. And when they see the worship of your church, they are going to want to get to know the one who saved you. Because they understand that if God can save you, God can save anybody. Not only if God can save you and save anybody, if God can save you and keep you saved, God can save and keep anybody saved. I don't know about you, but I've done enough wrong in my life that I should have been unsaved a long time ago. But I